bother to show up. Oh, I have to say, I'm both shocked, impressed, and dismayed at the level of attendance. So far, do you guys have jobs to look for? If you are an auditor, you are not allowed to be here. We don't have spare seats room. Also, if this persists and we have people who are paying customers sitting in the aisles, we will force you into a buddy system where you will have to check in at the door with a buddy on the theory that our auditors won't be able to find buddies. But if that happens, you have to rat the auditors out. There's no other way we're going to control this crowd unless we really call the roll, which will be extending the class really for another hour and a half every day. So you have to use moral suasion against the auditors. Is that clear? We're not allowed. Student affairs has actually got complaints from the paying customers. And the aim, as you know, is to serve. Okay, I'm going to talk a little bit about that and what's important and what's not, and the theory that your head is spinning slightly. First of all, the other asset value without $12.2 billion. Don't worry so much about the details of where that came from, especially the intangibles. The procedure you want to have a good sense of. You can either work down the balance sheet, or you can just start with book value and just add the additions. If you think there's excess property, plant equipment, subtract the subtractions, and so on. Then you'll learn to do on the job. You'll remember the details of what we tell you to do on that here. In terms of valuing the intangibles, whether you do it as a number of years of SG&A, or whether you do it the way we did it, which is item by item, look at the cost of reproducing the product portfolio, the sales relationships, and the trade labor force, going to sort of industry numbers for what you would pay headhunters to acquire the labor force, going to what you would pay a sales agency to acquire the sales in terms of commissions and so on, doesn't really matter. Well, turns out the reason this course is different from the past is we're in the process of producing a second edition of the book. All this will be in the second edition of the book, and you can read it then, which is when you really need to know, which is when you're out in the world doing this stuff. So I would not worry so much about the details of that. But I would pay attention to the basic idea, and particularly to the story that gets told when you finally do the numbers. So you have about $12.2 billion of asset value, and about, if you look at the earnings power value, is about $9.5 billion. Now, where is Mike? Gotta be here after giving. Okay. Mike did an extremely valuable service last time and deserves a hand. I want to show you how easy it is to do Mike's impairment. What Mike is worried about is, what about those plants, those relationships that are related to the U.S. auto industry that may or may not be gone? Well, you can identify the fraction of sales, the fraction of the labor force, and the fraction of property, plant, equipment that's associated with that, and that comes to about $4.4 billion. And also the product expenditures for these focused products. The working capital is probably going to be recoverable. You're certainly going to earn a return on that as the industry does. So that's about $4.4 billion. What fraction of that, realistically, and Mike Duncan, that's here, Ron, I need you as a stooge here. Do you think realistically it's going to be impaired?
It's like 50%.
You learned
obedience. It should, the U.S. auto industry isn't going to go away that quickly. If you want to see what it's like, the British auto industry died. The French auto industry has been dying for years. God knows what's keeping the Italian auto industry alive. You have a lot of data that you can look at to sort of tie this down and get away from the fears that say, this is going to be such a catastrophe, I'm going to put zero on this. So if it's about half of that, this is about half the capital, because the other half of capital is in Europe for companies like Daimler and so on. The Martin Memorial impairment is about $2.2 billion. The asset value starting out at 12.2, you're left with about $10 billion, and earnings power value of 9.5 billion. That means the 4% return that we use is about as pessimistic as Mike's view of what the assets are likely to do in the future. So if you want to take a view that, of what Mike's, basically you're saying this is worth about $9.5 to $10 billion. If you divide by 1.112 million shares to 113 million shares, that's about $90 a share versus $20 a share of price, which is a massive margin of safety. Yeah, it's not so massive now, but again, you always want to compare the margin of safety to what's available in alternative investments. There are meant to be, I think, a lot of uncertainty. Mike did a very good job of identifying one of the central uncertainties here. So once you've got the basic structure out, now, what story does that tell? Are there wasted assets here? Is the Stronach family in all its glory comparable to the clowns at Hudson General? And I think you'll see the answer is almost immediately no. That earnings power value is very close to the asset value. It's not a difference like you see at Hudson General, where the asset value is $130 million and the earnings power value is $40. Discrepancies like 12 to 9 or 10 to 9.5 are not really significant discrepancies within the limit of the degree to which you can calculate this. So you have a reasonably well-managed company here. The second question that came up is, does it look like there's a franchise here, so we have to worry about the value of the growth? Again, if the asset value and the earnings power value are about the same, what does that say about the existence of a franchise? They're just earning the cost of reproducing their assets. It doesn't look like there are big barriers to entry. If you know, how many of you brought your books? If you just go to the value line tear sheet, you'll see what the return on equity looks like for that. In the past, it was actually the auto industry did really well. It was quite good. If you average over what looks like a cycle, it's maybe 10-11%. Because you've got some 4-4.5% there. Well, does that return on equity suggest there's a powerful franchise here? No, it's not really. It's about what you'd expect. It's a very risky business. You want at least probably 10% return on the equity, even though it's highly unlevered. So the ROE is okay, not great. And again, that's consistent with the asset value equal earnings power value, and it's a reasonable story. Is there share stability here? And that's, again, something you want to look at. And what's the obvious answer? And this is something that comes up again and again. You think that Magna's share of this market has been growing. Of course it has. It's growing much faster than the automobile industry, from sort of $6 billion to $24 billion over a period of about 10 to 11 years. If Magna can grow that fast, does it suggest that there are barriers to entry here? No, it got in Europe, it got in to other suppliers in the United States. If Magna can enter, it almost suggests that there are no barriers to other people too. That's why, in a sense, it's never a good sign if in an industry like this, you see one company growing particularly rapidly. Because the narrative gets to be that, you see they're slaughtering everybody else. If they can slaughter everybody else, it means there are no barriers to entry and nobody else has competitive advantages, and they're unlikely to have competitive advantages. So if the other people were not protected by customer captivity and scale, it's unlikely Magna's going to be protected by competitive advantages and scale. Is that clear? But then you do want to look directly at customer captivity. And who are the customers here? They're the big auto companies. After they sign the contract, they are captive. But when they sign a new contract for a new part, do they just give Magna whatever price Magna wants, the way you give Marlboro cigarettes, whatever price, the combination of the government and Philip Morris wants? No, there is a negotiation. They like to have multiple sources. They don't like to be captive, and they understand that process. So even though once the contract is signed for the life of that part, there is significant captivity, just as in the case of Hudson General, once they have the airport contract, there is significant captivity. That captivity is something you pay for up front, because you're getting into the contract, everybody knows you're going to have the profits of the captivity later in the life of the contract, and that comes into the deal. You may get some slight scale advantages, but in a case like this, where their facilities are also spread all over the world, there's not a great big core scale. But they're competing for new contracts with other people all over. So it doesn't look like there's a franchise here. And that tells us that we sort of have a consistent narrative that, George, it may not be completely Mike's narrative. He may be a little more pessimistic. But it's very close to Mike's narrative. It's a reasonably conservative margin. It involves a reasonable write-down in the assets. And there's no franchise here to create value from growth. What you see is what you get. It's worth about $10 million. How many people thought it was worth buying at $2.2 billion? Everybody. And she's also getting 1.7 billion in cash. Today, what is it, Mike? 55? I don't know, it was up today, right? Okay, so it's 55 to 60. The margin of safety is smaller, but again, it's smaller for everything that's available. And the notion that the global car industry is going to die has really substantially receded as companies like Ford got help from have actually made a profit in the face of their union. Is there any question about that? Because then I want to talk about this process of fraud detection. Yes?
How that sells? I mean, we talked a lot about that. Like, what price, how do you think that sells?
Ah, okay. Really great question. And when the speakers come, you'll have to ask them that. What's my biggest fishing on when to sell? When it gets to 90. Why? Because A, once you sell, you have to pay the capital gains tax. So you have to pay, and when Obama gets finished, and the state of New York gets finished, that may be a lot of money. You're tax-free equity, you're an endowment or a pension fund, you can obviously sell more conservatively. But right away, you're going to lose at least 15% of the gain from, so at the 70, you're going to lose 15%, which is about $10 when you sell. So if you sell at 90, you're going to realize 80. So that's the first thing you have to pay attention to. Second very little secret is the one that we let Kano tell you, which normally in value classes we don't let out, which is what, Kano?
I don't know.
Momentum values in the short run. As if this ran up to 90, the chances are it would run above 90. So probably as it goes through 90, if you have the guts, you want to start selling off slowly over that to take advantage of the market. That said, if you're really a nervous Nelly, where should you sell this? Mike?
60.
Exactly. Okay, so now you know who you want to manage your money. If you want something that's really careful, there's the banner. Now, if you want to play the game,
I'm here.
Any other questions? Yes.
What do you make of the argument that you want somebody else to see some runway park at a discount to that?
There's a market price up there. If you own 10-12% of the company, you'd have to worry about that. Because take your months, you want to do the position, you'd be a large share of daily volume, you want to have a liquid market, you don't want a market that's sort of turning. But if you're a small fraction of the company, you're like less than 10% of daily volume. You're not going to have any trouble.
But if you see it as being a fundamentally $90 stock, you'd have to bet somebody's going to see.
Do you think people never pay $110 for $90 stocks?
Yeah, I'm sure they do.
Especially if they've quadrupled in the last year. I have a lot of history on that. Stocks that go up, people get excited about. As long as the market is there, I wouldn't worry about not being able to sell it. Now, the second concern, clearly the more expensive that stock is, the closer it is to that $90 value, the more money you've got at risk. But I think that's the fundamental judgment you want to make. I don't think you want to be in the business of doing favors for the people on the other side of the trade, right? They're not going to help you out. Suppose you don't sell it at, you sell it at 80, and it goes to 120. Try calling those people up and saying, how about you give me another 20? Okay? I would just figure out how much risk you want to take, how much of a margin of safety you want to take, and unless you're a big fraction of the company, I would just live with that. Are there any subset of questions about this? All right, so the last thing I want to go through, because I think it's worth doing, is this process of fraud detection. I don't want to talk about it with the complexity of the MAGNA numbers up there. I just want to give you an example because I think that's what you'll remember is the simple version. So what's the number that's the bottom line of what a business produces? It's the profit. And if the accountants have done their job well, that profit ought to be what they could give you in cash at the end of the year without impairing the position of the company, that is, while putting it back in the position it was at the beginning of the year. So you want to start with the profit, but you want to ask the question, is that reported profit an honest profit? So you've got to start asking the question, where did it go? Strictly speaking, if this was an outright business, it should all go all down into your pocket. But they should distribute all of it because it should be the distributable earnings. So start with what they pay out. So say they report a profit over 10 years because year by year they can do a lot of manipulation. So you add up all the profits from, or 5 or 10 years from say 1999 or 2000 to 2009, or from 2005 to 2009, which is 5 years. Suppose that comes to 1.5 billion. First thing you want to do is ask, how much of that did they distribute in dividends and net buybacks? It's really hard to fake that. If they say, we paid this dividend, and you're a stockholder and the check got lost in the mail, and you call your friend, and he says, oh, I didn't get a check either. Those guys are going to get caught. They're not going to last as long as Bernie Madoff. And Bernie Madoff, got to ask for money. He delivered it. Okay? Suppose you add up the dividends and net buybacks, which is buybacks of shares minus sales of new stock, and that's $500 million. Well, that means of the $1.5 billion, you've accounted for $500 million of it. You know where $500 million of it went. Okay, what's the next place it could go that you should have reasonable confidence that it's there? And the answer is net cash. So look, at the end of 2009, at cash minus debt, and look at, say, if you're doing a 10-year thing at the end of 1999 of cash minus debt, and see how much that net cash increased. And if it increased by $500 million, you know where another $500 million went. If it decreased by $500 million, it means you better find out where another $500 million went to. So the second thing that's very hard to fake, and the only case I know where somebody has faked it successfully is Parmalat, and that's because the Italians are artists in accounting as in everything else. That this is a reasonably reliable number. Is that clear? So suppose that's gone up, the net cash has gone up by reduced debt or the accumulated debt by $500 million. How much of that cumulative profit over 10 years do you still have to account for? Only $500 million. That went into the business someplace. You could presumably trace through the balance sheets and try and find out where it went. It turns out that's not always so easy to do. But you can ask a different question. Given that they put an extra $500 million into the business, did the business grow to an extent that suggests that that $500 million actually went into an identifiable expansion? Now, you could look at reported earnings, but remember, reported earnings can be an unreliable number, especially for 1 year. So if you take reported earnings in 2005 and reported earnings in 2009, you would get a very distorted number. But sales are harder to fake. You can run your receivables and do those manipulations, but if you've got a significant growth in sales, then that's hard to fake over a long period of time. So suppose in this case, you look at the growth in sales, and it was about $5 billion over the period where $500 million net went into the business. Does that suggest almost immediately that the $500 million is being put to good use? Yes. Businesses that operate 10 cents on the dollar of capital investment are typically really well-run businesses. Now, you might want to compare with other people in the industry to see. I mean, if the industry is at 4 cents on the dollar and these guys are at 10 cents on the dollar, it's not a good sign. But generally, 10 cents is a pretty low number. Suppose actually sales have increased by only $250 million. Putting $500 million into a business to get $250 million in sales, unless it's a utility or something else hugely capital intensive, suggests that you're not doing a very good job. So the last thing you want to do is take that amount that's been invested in the business and just divide by the increase in sales. If you did this for WorldCom, they reported $1 billion in net income. They distributed no dividends. Net cash went down by $14 billion. So they punitively put $24 billion into the business, and sales went up, not counting acquisitions, after acquisitions over the 2 years, 3 years, sorry, by about $4 billion. And in the last year, sales actually went down. So there, you're supposedly in this brilliant new age company, which is all vapor and telecom, putting $24 billion into the business for a $4 billion increase in sales. Lots of luck is being invested in that company. You have to know their crooks to know that whatever they're doing, there's a lot of value being destroyed there. That is, there's a lot of money being pumped into this business for no visible result. So are there any questions about this? Or is it completely self-evident? And it's a simple thing to do. And it's a matter of keeping track of what numbers are hard to fake. Okay? Any other questions before we go on to talk about how to evaluate growth stocks?
Yeah, did you use capital expenditures over that time period?
No, because they can fake it.
How
about? Oh, they say they take your operation. This is what WorldCom did. they take their ordinary repair and maintenance, and they call it all capital expenditures. So what happens to their reported maintenance costs? They are zero. So what happens to their reported profits? Remember, you can fake capital investment more than anything else, because you can fake depreciation, and you can fake what you call investments in equipment, because it's very hard to audit, especially for software and intangibles, which are now around. Focus on the things where, why are dividends, and let me put it this way, if you want to develop a measure like this anyway. Why are dividends and buybacks hard to fake? Go ahead.
People know if they haven't gotten the money.
There's another party on the opposite side of that transaction that ought to be able to see. But there's the recipients who know if they got the money or not. Why is net debt hard to fake? Or that cash rather hard to fake? Because there's a bank that holds the cash, and there are debtors who hold the debt. And it's just, there's another party who sees very clearly what those transactions, what those numbers should be. So they're hard to fake. Why are sales hard to fake in the long run? Again, because the customer is supposedly buying things. There's another part of the transaction. When you're spending internally on investment, is there another party to that transaction? No, there wasn't. WorldCom was just using its own people to, quote, build its network. And whenever there's not another party you can check with on the transaction, it's not going to be reliable. Okay?
Why are people blackberrying like crazy?
It's like, boy, what did I say?
They're sending it to their dogs.
Alright, so what I'm going to start, if there are no more questions about that, and I think it's that basic structure you want to remember. Asset value, earnings power value, the kind of analysis that might be in on that, where the threats are, what is the story that's being told here, is it consistent with the nature of the market, and ultimately then, how do you detect in this particular case, because it's a large issue, law on the part of these this man. Because if we're done, what I'm going to do is, of course, take you through what everything you should know, and then we're going to talk about valuing growth companies. So this is the process. You've seen it. You want a search. You want a valuation approach. You want to have a disciplined way to go out and collect information and check your valuation conclusions. And ultimately, you want to do risk management that we're going to talk about later. Why do you do the search process? Because you have to know why you're buying something. If you're buying it because your dentist told you, you're in real trouble. You want to have a sense that you are buying it because it's an opportunity based on established psychological biases. Or you just want to stay away from lottery tickets or institutional biases or limited competition from other investors if the family just has to dump it and there are not a lot of buyers, or because you have a special competence in this. That's the benefit of specialization. Or you're good at observing expert behavior. I mean, you can legally get inside information. And also you're very disciplined about insisting that there be a rationality. So whenever you buy something, you ought to have a sense of why you're buying it, and that's really the heart of your search strategy. You obviously want to know what you're buying. The problem with a DCF calculation is it's not good at telling you what it is that you're getting for your money. You're just getting a lot of projected cash flows, and they can be almost anything. You have to know where does the value reside, and how do you measure it? If there's one focus on this course in the valuation part, it's measuring things reliably from as many mutually supporting perspectives as you can find. And again, a DCF approach doesn't do that. What information do you bring to bear? If you can make a good conjecture about the future of the auto industry, because you've looked at Italy, you've looked at the UK, you've looked at France, you want to know, is it easy to bring that information to bear in the context of this framework? And there's both qualitative and quantitative measures, and also how reliable ultimately are these measures of valuation. You want to have a feel for how reliable our $130 million valuation for Hudson General was, and what do you think the errors probably were on that, reasonably? Absolutely at most plus or minus $20 million. But you've had that really pinned down fairly accurately. In terms of Magna, what do you think the likely errors are? Probably plus or minus $2 billion. They're probably substantially higher because, of course, we don't have the kind of detailed information. And we don't have the benefit of a buyer, for most of it, for cash at almost half the value in basically cash. So you want a valuation process that enables you to know what you're buying. Basically, what that consists of is an asset value, an earnings power value, and you're going to defer the consideration of growth until today. Ultimately, when you've done those two things, you're either in this situation, which is Hudson General, you're in this situation with Magna, where you can buy it because you're getting a $2.2 billion price, which is way below this. Or you're in this situation, which is what we're going to talk about today. If you're in this situation where the assets really don't matter much, where you've got competitive advantages that give you outsized earnings that you hope are sustainable so you can pay for them, the crucial thing to understand is the sustainability of those earnings. And if they're not protected by assets, they've got to be protected by barriers to entry, and we've talked ad nauseum about what they are. Proprietary technology or resources, captive customers, and ultimately economies of scale. Whether it's network externalities or fixed costs. When you go look at those, remember, you have to look at it on a market-by-market basis. Anybody who tells you this company has 6% of the global market, or this company has 25% of the global market, is wasting your time. You want to know individual market by individual market where they make money. The classic case of that, who's the biggest cell phone vendor in the world? Cell phone company in the world. No, I mean not the man, I mean the systems operators. It's basically Vodafone. Vodafone is a British company. Does that mean they're profitable in Britain? No. Their market share in Britain is 25%, and they don't make that much money because it's all over the place, and they have their facilities all over the place. Where do they make their money? Italy, where they're close to 50%, in Germany, where they're 40%, and in countries like France, where they're 10% or less, or God help them, although they didn't do this stupidity, if they were as dumb as Deutsche Telekom in the United States, at 5%, they're never going to make a penny there. So remember, you have to look on a market-by-market basis. If you can look regionally, you want to do that. Large global markets are very difficult to dominate. Typically, you want a company that dominates local markets, either in product space like Microsoft, Intel, and pharmaceutical companies that have specialties, Pfizer, who decides they're only going to do blockbuster drugs, surprise, surprise, and dominate the global markets, turns out to be a disaster. Or in geography like the cell phone companies and the retailers. Now, today, we are going to talk about buying growth companies. What you have to understand is, this is the unsafe sex of the investing world. And you have to be comparably careful here. Remember the data that Kano showed you. People who invest in growth indiscriminately typically underperform. The data indicates investors systematically overpay for growth, so you want to be very careful. It is the least reliable element of value. It's really where you don't know what you're buying because it's all out in the future, and it's extremely highly sensitive to the assumptions. We're going to talk about that problem. Historically, value investors wanted the growth for free. For a franchise company, if you read the early Buffett letters, he would pay full value for the current earnings power of Coke. When he bought it, it was at 12 times sustainable earnings. It's about an 8% return, which is about the cost of capital of a big, safe company like Coke without any debt or any significant leverage. So he bought the earnings power and he wanted the value of the growth for free. Increasingly, because value tends to reside here, you are inevitably going to have to look at it, and you want to look at it properly. The first thing you have to know is that in growth, there are two basic forces at work. First, a growing street is worth more than a stable street. No question about it. If I have a stream that's a dollar this year, a dollar next year, a dollar the year afterwards, I'm not going to be as rich as somebody who has a dollar six next year, $1.12. But, and this is what everybody forgets in their excitement over the first factor, almost always you have to invest to support the growth. So the distributable part of the growing earnings stream at any moment in time is less than the distributable part of the earnings for the non-growing stream, and it's less by the amount you have to invest to support the growth. And the question is, where did those two forces balance? Where does growth on balance create value? Where does it not create value? And where does it destroy value? And it turns out that if you look at growth properly, it's really easy to tell. And you've seen this slide before. Anyway, any of you ever become teachers? The hardest thing to do is to repeat yourself over and over again. Because the tragedy of being a teacher is until you get to be really experienced, you listen to yourself all the time. In my last years at Wesleyan, I'd stopped listening to myself. So in fact, I was really a perfect teaching machine. Except that once I was writing on the board and I realized I was going, ha ha ha. And another time I realized I was talking and I had completely lost track of where I was on the lecture. And so I said to them, where was I? They said, you were here, and I knew immediately and just went on. Even the best students only listen about 40% of the time. So if there's real value to repetition, then you've got to just power through it. So you have seen this chart before, but it bears repeat. The way to think about the value of growth is not to focus on the growth rate. Focus on the investment required to support the growth. So suppose we're going to invest $100 million to support the growth. We have to pay the people. This is force two of what I showed you, the negative factor. Whatever the cost of capital is, say 10% for the use of that $100 million. So we have to pay $10 million, and if the growth is there always, the $100 million will be there always, and we have to pay it every year. Suppose we invest that $100 million at a competitive disadvantage. We're probably going to make, well, we're certainly going to make less than 10%. We may make nothing at all. Say we make 5%. So we earn every year on that $100 million, because there has been a growth in sales, $5 million a year, but we have to pay $10 million for the people who supply the funds. So what am I left with? I'm left with a net loss of $5 million a year from that growth in sales. Doesn't show up on the income statement because typically the $10 million is retained earnings, but really, I have destroyed about $5 million a year in value, and if I'm discounted at 10%, I've destroyed $50 million. If you invest at a competitive disadvantage, either because you're a stone-cold stupid, you've got an incompetent management, or because somebody else has a competitive advantage in that market and you didn't have the discipline to stay out, That growth will destroy value. Now, most of the time, acquisitions destroy value. Why? Because buying other companies is a business any fool with a checkbook can get into. Anybody can invest in stocks. What do acquiring companies do? They have a two-pronged investment strategy. Prong one is they don't diversify. They buy whole companies. Prong two is, because prong one is so brilliant, they're not going to pay market price. They're going to pay 20 to 50% above market price. How many of you want to invest with those people? It's a classic way to invest at a competitive disadvantage. And it almost always destroys value unless you bring something to the table. Well, suppose I go into a new market, Chinese retail. I get a lot of people entering the Chinese retail market. Yes, there are. Are there any significant barriers to entry at the moment? No, there are not. It's like the New York retail market. It is very dense. There are a lot of people in there. What's going to limit the expansion of stores and the tendency of that increase in offerings to split the market more narrowly, to raise the fixed cost like Tyler showed you, and to eliminate the profitability of the store? Presumably, entry is only going to stop when people can no longer earn their cost of capital. So if you invest in that $100 million in a market that is subject to competition, you're going to make 10%. You're going to pay 10% to the people who provided the $100 million. You make $10 million. You pay $10 million. The value creation is zero. Investing in a market that's competitive, where there are no barriers to entry, and you have no competitive advantage, is not a way to create value. The negative effect of the required investment just outweighs the positive effect of the growing earnings. It's only where you can earn 20% on that investment and pay 10% that growth creates value. For that to be sustainably true, you have to have a competitive advantage in the market in which you are, into which you are growing. Is that clear? Even if you are in a competitive market like China and demand grows, so temporarily your return goes from 10 to 12%, what happens next? Everybody says, wow, I can make 12% in China. They open stores and they drive the return right back down to 10%. So it's only in that last case that growth creates value. Growth in a competitive advantage, disadvantage, destroys value. And the way that happens is somebody like AT&T in 1982 looks at IBM's market and says, God, they're making so much money. I wish in that market. I'm going to get into that market. The reason they're making so much money in that market is because you and people like you can't get into that market. And it's a real Groucho Marx problem. They lost $200 billion over the course of their career trying to get into that market and failing. And you will notice the original AT&T is no longer with us. They got eaten by one of their children that just belts out. And the same will happen to you. When Walmart first went into England until they got scale does not create or destroy value. It's only franchise growth that creates value. In terms of what you see when you get to your earnings power and asset value, it's here that growth creates value. Now, also in general, unless the growth is high, I don't want to talk about this a lot because the formula is in the book. And the detail of the formula is not something you want to pay attention to so much as the message here. What's across the top is the return on invested capital divided by the cost of capital. So if your cost of capital is 10, the first column is if you earn 10% on your investments. The second column is if you earn 15, the third column is 20, 25, and 30. Down the side is the ratio between the growth rate and the cost of capital. So again, if the cost of capital is 10, The point you find means that that market is growing at 2.5%. If it's 0.5, it means the market is growing at 5% and then 7.5. The thing to notice is the real value creation is all down here. Around here and across low growth rates, there's not big value creation. You'll only start to pay high multiples with high growth rates and very powerful franchises. So the first thing you want to keep in mind is it takes a lot of growth to justify an outrageously high multiple. So growth is both often not valuable, and even where it is valuable, it is usually less valuable quantitatively than people think it is. Then the question is, if I'm going to go ahead anyway, and I want to value growth companies, how can I do it? And the problem is this. There are two ways that you can do this. We're going to have to confront the problem of growth. We cannot. These slides, by the way, you don't have. They will be around. They will be put on the... My angel, is it angel or is it boss? Angel is the they will be on angel by certainly Thursday, I hope. So what you've got is the ratio of the value of the price is equal to the cash flow times 1/1 the difference between the cost of capital and the growth rate, which is the value, divided by the price. And typically what you want is that value over the price to be greater than some margin of safety. That is essentially, by the way, that term, the cash flow times 1/r-g, is what you did when you did an NPV. It's just doing the terminal value right up front. And if you do a detailed cash flow NPV, it's not going to be all that different. There is another way to do this, and significantly, we told you not to do it in 6301, and we were wrong. And that is to say, let's not look at value to price. Let's start with what it means to have the value to price be substantially greater than 1. And all I'm going to do is multiply both sides of this equation by r minus g. That surely is just high school algebra. Well, so if the value is greater than the price, it means that the cash flow return is greater than the difference between the cost of capital and the growth rate. If I bring the growth rate just for, I add the growth rate to both sides of the equation, it cancels out here, and what I get is that the cash flow return, the distributable earnings return, which is the cash flow divided by the price, plus the growth rate, has got to be greater than your cost of capital. That's another way of looking at the same problem. So you can look at it that the value has to be greater than the price, or the total return, the cash flow return plus the growth that drives capital gains, has got to be significantly greater than your cost of capital. That is basically an IRR approach. Yes?
Contrast look at... return on invested capital.
Hold that thought. This is basically the terms of the investment. The return on invested capital will determine what the growth rate is and will determine to some extent what that cash flow return is. But I think we want to look at the simple basic things first and not do sort of complicated calculations that vary that factor. We're going to return to that basic factor. We're going to look at the return on invested capital in some detail. Okay? Just bear with me for a second. Alright, so I can either approach it this way or this way. Now, the fundamental problem is this. When you relate growth rates and costs of capital to value, the curve is a hyperbola like that. If you're down at the bottom here, where there's no growth and a reasonably high cost of capital, making a mistake in R doesn't make a big mistake in valuation. If you're down here, small mistakes in your estimated growth rate and the cost of capital lead to large mistakes in value. If you want to just see an example of some numbers, if I take just the cash flow times 1 minus R minus R, the typical cost of capital is 10, a growth rate is 5, I'm going to multiply that cash flow by 20. If the growth rate is 4 and the cost of capital is 11, which is just a 1% mistake in either direction, then it's 1 over 11 minus 4%, which is 1 over 7%, which is not 20, it's 14, which is more than 50% less. If I have a 1% mistake the other way, so the growth rate is actually 9, I'm sorry, the cost of capital is 9 and the growth rate is 6, I have 1 over 9 minus 6, which is 1 over 3%, which is 33. Small mistakes in those estimates of R minus G lead to large mistakes in valuation. Once you recognize that fact, which of these two measures is going to be better to use? This is one where the changes in the growth rate and the cost of capital have a huge effect on your measure of value and a huge effect on your margin of safety. If this is the way I do it, how does the growth rate and cost of capital enter? Linearly and on opposite sides of the equation. The growth rate is 1% higher. What does it do to the return that you get? Just goes up by 1%. The cost of capital is 1% higher or lower. What does it do to the required return that you're going to compare that return to? It just raises it or lowers it by 1%. So it is the second approach that is far more transparent for this dangerous business of valuing growth stocks than the way we taught you. In fact, you are better off doing an IRR, it turns out. As complicated as the formula looked when you did it in 6301, than you are doing an NPV. And when you look at Warren Buffett, the way he values these stocks is, he looks for a target return and a margin of safety between that return he thinks he's going to get at the existing market price and multiple, and what his cost of capital is. In his case, the target return he looks for is 13%. Glenn Greenberg, who if you're in the other class, you'll get to hear, who is another extraordinarily successful growth stock investor, and probably the second most successful one in these kinds of Buffett stocks, also looks for a return. He looks for a 15% return. The reason God is just is that if you do the right approach, the numbers don't matter. If you look over the last 25 years, Buffett and Van Greenberg have roughly exactly the same return. So, but you want to do it in terms of return. So, the crucial thing to understand about a value approach to investing is it's not a one-size-fits-all approach. If you don't have to worry about the growth, because the growth is not that valuable, there's no franchise, the asset value ought to be roughly equal to the earnings power value. Do the asset value, the earnings power value, look at the story it tells and investigate your margin of safety. What we did at Hudson General, it's what we did with Madden. If you want to do Buffett stocks, of which Coca-Cola is preeminent, where you're going to buy earnings, you better, first of all, have a strong, sustainable, competitive advantage slash franchise slash barriers to entry. Typically, in that case, the earnings power value is going to be way in excess of the asset value. So you're not going to spend a lot of time worrying about assets. If you think it's a weak franchise that's going to go away, you may be left with the assets. But what you're going to buy there are earnings, because it's the economic situation that's protecting them, not the assets. So you're going to look at earnings power values, and there's going to be a significant value to growth. What you're going to do, though, is not look at a value. You're going to look at an implied return at the current price, which is distributed cash plus capital gains, and look at a margin of safety versus returns available in the market. It is a fundamentally different approach, and what it's driven by is this principle of knowing what you know in valuation. What is the best, most transparent way to use the information that you have on estimated cash flows, on growth rates, and on cost of capital. And what I'm going to do for the rest of this evening is talk about applying this second method. And there are, again, two ways to do it. And that's good because it enables you to, again, triangulate. None of this is all handwritten ones are new. We'll get it typed up and we'll get it on the way. The first is, yes, sorry.
Is the R that we're supposed to use as our hurdle rate the same as the R that we use in the earnings power value as our
cost? It should be, but let's think about it. I'll talk about this, but I might as well talk about this. Suppose that if you bought a market portfolio, you would earn about 7%. If you buy one of these growth stocks at a particular price, the only judgment you have to make is, do you think this is more or less risky than the market portfolio? So, for example, we're going to talk in a second about Microsoft. Do you think that Microsoft at a less than market multiple, or approximately the same multiple to earnings as the market, is more or less risky than the stock market as a whole? Almost certainly less. They have $40 billion in cash. They have no price competition, that the earnings could evaporate, but actually if you look at their most vulnerable sector, which is servers, their market share in servers is growing. Compare that to Magna, who could get wiped out right now with the U.S. auto industry. So what you want to do is start with a market return. Then make a judgment, in much the way we did at getting a cost of equity for a while. Make a judgment about whether this is high risk or low risk relative to the market, and get your comparison cost of capital accordingly. So if the market return is 7, what you want to do is a comparison return for Microsoft. Go ahead and use 7. You've got a big margin of safety over 7. You've got 13, 14, 15%. My advice to you is buy Microsoft all day long. And forget what multiple it is, you know, what the quote value is compared to the price. So what you're going to do is, first, you have to verify that a franchise exists in the part of the business where you're going to pay for the growth. That the earnings power value is significantly higher than an asset value. There are high returns on equity and high returns on invested capital historically. On average, stable market share and no real entry here. But they have 90% share, and typically that means they'll grow with the market. Once you've done that, calculate, first of all, just the cash return. Dividends and buybacks, on average, divided by the market value. So all you have to do is say, look, and if you look at Microsoft, they've been distributing about $15 to $16 billion in cash for the last several years. Their market value after you take the cash on their balance sheet out is about $200 billion at the moment. It fluctuates day to day. That means you're getting in Microsoft about an 8% cash return. So start with just that cash return. Look at the history of dividends and buybacks, and that's where you start. That's the first component of your return. What's the second component of your return? It's capital gains. What's going to drive capital gains in the long run? Growth in earnings. What's going to drive growth in earnings? Growth in the market in which this firm operates. Why should you not put a high growth rate on the firm sales itself as opposed to a high, just the market growth rate? Because if there are barriers to entry, what should be true of market shares? They should be stable. So the fact that you're tempted to put a high growth rate on Magna almost tells you that it is not a firm with significant competitive advantages. So look at the market in which they are. and see how fast that market is going to grow, and presumably they're retaining enough earnings to grow with that market. And it's going to be GDP plus if it's growing faster than world GDP, or it's going to be GDP minus. So you're going to get those capital gains plus the earnings. Now, I took a lowball on the dividends and buybacks, but say it was for, say the future growth rate is sort of the growth rate of the physical computer market plus the growth rate of nominal GDP, plus they actually get 1% because their earnings grow because they have operating leverage. So you have 8% growth. You can compare that to historical and recent growth rates in earnings and in sales. You got a 4% cash return. The total return is what that you get from owning Microsoft? About 12%. If the market return, you want to compare that to, well, the dividend return on the S&P at the moment is about 2.5%. That profits should grow with GDP. The value of the market should grow with profits. That's 4.5% probably. You have a market return of 2.5% in dividends plus 4.5% is still. Right away, without any of these difficulties of these small changes in the growth rate and the cost of capital affecting things, you have a significant margin of safety, it looks like here, that should cover the risk of the franchise disappearing. So that is method one. The problem is, what doesn't it address? Well, of the profits that they make, some of this growth is being driven and could be accelerated by an effective allocation of capital. So you want to take a look in detail at what they're doing inside the firm with your money and see the implications of that for the return. Now here is actually the Microsoft return. So when Microsoft was at 17, by the way, just in this year they have low buybacks, it was 6.5. The volume growth was 4. They had some significant pricing power of 2.5. The operating leverage, if you looked historically, was about 1.5. Then you had about 8% growth. It's a 14% return. In those days, the dividend return on the S&P was about 3.5. 4.5 growth is 8. So you have 14.5 versus 8% when Microsoft was at 17. In fact, it's actually a little more than that. It was about a 15 to 18% return if you really looked at it carefully. And we're going to do that in a second. That kind of return you should be happy to get all day long. And sooner or later, if you're getting that kind of return, the market return is at 7%, and Microsoft is trading at the same earnings return or distribution return as the market, what's going to happen to Microsoft's multiple? It's going to go up. So you're probably also, in the long run, going to get some appreciation. The second way to do this is to do it another way comparable to the way you can do the overall market return. So the star, again, you've got to verify the franchise is there. If the franchise is there, you're not going to look at these return values. Then calculate the earnings return. Get your earnings power. Correct for things because dividend policies can change and be unstable to some extent. You'd like to have a feel for starting with the earnings ability of this enterprise. Start with an earnings return. Not now with the dividend immediately. That earnings return is going to get divided into two parts. First, they're going to give some of it to you in cash. And sometimes companies like American Express have stated policies. American Express expects to distribute about 65%, almost two-thirds of their earnings, in cash. So if you are earning a 10% return on the price of the stock, and again, the earnings power ought to be a good number, the price ought to be a good number, that 10% ought to be a reasonably reliable number, they're going to distribute 6.5%. And they're going to reinvest 3.5. What is the 3.5 that they're going to reinvest worth? That's the crucial thing. And this is where The return on capital matters a lot. And it's the return on capital where they are putting that money. If their cost of capital is 10 and they earn 10, how much value are they creating for each dollar they reinvest? $1. They don't destroy value, so for that 3.5% they reinvest, it's worth 3.5%. If they are reinvesting at 20% and the return is 10, the cost of capital is 10, every dollar they reinvest, that return is worth $2. That means the 3.5% reinvested as they expand to new geographies or new markets, it's going to be worth 7%. So you want to look at the value of the earnings in terms of what you get directly and the value created through reinvestment. Lastly, the value you get through reinvestment will show up as part of the growth. What we're really doing here is we're decomposing the growth into a growth attributable to new capital allocation and new initiatives, and a growth that's attributable to just organic growth in either pricing or same-store sales or existing product line sales that typically requires almost no investment. So we're going to start with the cash return, we're going to add the value created by reinvestment, and lastly, we're going to look at organic growth. What's going to drive organic growth? GDP growth. We're going to start with GDP growth. Now, in most markets like China, it's not worth anything because it just attracts entry. If your franchise grows with GDP, you'll grow with relatively little investment at the GDP rate, and you'll create that much more capital gains. If you grow faster than GDP, and there are probably two reliable indicators of faster growth than GDP. One is rich people's incomes have gone up significantly faster than poor people's incomes. So if you're Walmart and you're serving a working class population, your organic growth, which is same-store sales growth, is going to be less than GDP growth. Surprise, surprise, guess what same-store sales growth has looked like for a long time for Walmart? About 1 to 2% at most. If you're catering to rich people, you're going to grow faster than world GDP, maybe 6 to 7%. The second thing is that incrementally people in the world spend a lot more on services, medical care and so on, than they do on goods. Medical care growth in the United States is about 6 to 7%. It's about 2% faster than overall GDP growth, 1 to 2% faster. So you start with the earnings return, how much of it gets paid out, the return created by retained earnings, and then the organic growth gets added to that. And you can compare that return to the one you calculated just by looking at the dividend return plus extrapolated historical growth. So suppose they don't create any value by reinvestment, that the earnings return is 6.5%, and this is by the way the market. The market return is about 16 times sustainable earnings that the S&P is trading at. It's obviously trading more richly compared to recent earnings. So the market return in this case is about 6.5, which is 1/16/17. The thing you get on top of that is just inflation. Because for real growth, you have to reinvest some of those earnings. Inflation is maybe 1.5%, so you get 6.5 plus 1.5, which is 8. Notice that's a slightly higher estimate than the one we got as dividends plus the growth in GDP. In general, that recently has been the case. But what's a good average measure of what the alternative market return is today? It's about 7.5%. And you're looking for a decent margin of safety of above 7.5%. That's the average of the 7 we calculated before and the 7.5 that we calculated here. The hard thing here, but the thing that is so informative about this approach for growth companies is that it focuses you on how effectively are they allocating profit? And that's something Buffett talks about all the time. The first approach doesn't really do that. Here you're going to do a lot of research on allocating capital, and I thought I'd show you just what that research would look like. So I want to show you what the reinvestment returns look like for Home Depot and what you have to do to calculate. Okay. Home Depot puts its extra money into new stores. That's how Home Depot expands. Same store sales growth just really requires a little bit of inventory. And that's offset by accounts payable, so there's not a lot of investment for same store sales growth. Same store sales growth is your organic growth. You have to know the economics of a new Home Depot store to understand how much value they're creating by store growth. So the first thing you need to know is that in its mature state, a Home Depot store typically sells $34 million a year. In its first year, it sells only about $24 million. In its second year, about $27 million. In its third year, $30 million. Its fourth year, $32 million. And it takes 5 years to get up to scale. If you look historically, those numbers were actually given by Home Depot in its glory years. Home Depot's gross margin is about 40%. So on the $24 million in sales, they make about $9.6 million in gross margin the first year, up to $13.6 million when the store is mature. That's also a number that you can actually get from your financials. Overhead per store is about $10.2 million. And that's a number that people pretty much know, which means that the operating income per store, the first year they lose $600 million, the second year they make $600 million, then $1.8 million, then $2.6 million, then $3.4 million. If you convert that to after-tax at about a one-third tax rate, it's minus $400,000, then plus $400,000, then plus $1.2 million, plus $1.7 million, and $2.2 million. To set up a store takes about $14 million in investment in fixtures and so on, local advertising to start up, and about $1 million in working capital. And as sales grow, of course, the working capital grows. So your investment is $15 million the first year, up to $16.9 million. If your cost of investment is about 10%, to cover that investment, you'd have to pay yourself $1.5 million in the first year, $1.55 million in the second, $1.59 million, which is just 10% of what's invested. If you look, therefore, at the real economic profit, you have an actual accounting profit of $400 million. To justify the capital invested, you should have a profit of $1.5 million. You are, in effect, losing $1.9 million the first year. The second year, you are losing $1.15 million, then $0.39 million, then you go to profit. At the end of the day, you make about $500 million a year. The mature store, over and above its cost on working and fixed capital, creates about $5.1 million in value. But if you blow up the losses along the way, because you've got to cover those and you have to pay the 10% on the losses along the way come to $4.7 million. So what do you make on that $15 million investment at the end of 5 years? You make about $400,000. You discount back to the present, you make about 1.6% pure economic profit. So does new store opening create any significant value above the capital invested for Home Depot? No, it doesn't, but it doesn't destroy value. And that's an important thing to recognize. There are areas where Walmart, especially overseas, destroys a ton of value. But you can see that this is information you really want to know about if you're paying for the future of Home Depot. Does that answer your question on return on invested capital and how it plays in? So basically, what you see is what you get. What they retain in earnings, they create that much value, they don't particularly destroy them. Okay, so you have two ways to get at what these returns are compared to that market return of 7 to 8%. One is just looking at distributed dividends plus some measure of historical growth. The other way is to break it down, look at the distributed return, look at the growth generated by reinvested capital, because that's forward-looking, and look at the growth from organic growth and things like same-store sales growth. What I'm going to do is actually ignore the Cisco, or I'm just going to do three of these. These are all what look like franchise stocks that people got very excited about when the market started to break, say, at the middle or the end of 2007, say, early 2008. There's Walmart. They have some slight customer captivity. They have huge local economies of scale. American Express. There's a lot of habit formation and credit card use. They have some economies of scale in marketing and negotiating with IM merchants. You've got Gannett, which is local newspapers, a lot of customer captivity, and huge local economies of scale. If you look at their ROEs, they tend to be well above their cost of capital, especially if I took out the cash, so that by that standard, they seem to be franchises. Also, they tend to dominate their markets. People are typically not moving in on Gannett newspapers. They're not, they have 100% market share locally. Walmart share locally has been very stable. American Express's share of high-end credit cards has been growing slightly, but not as much as they'd like to pretend. So here's Gannett in December 2007, where a company that had always sold at 20 to 25 times earnings and then got down to 16 to 12 was now selling at 8 times earnings. Was that a bargain? Again, if you did a discounted cash flow, you could fairly easily justify that in terms of a cost of capital and growth rate. If you look at an average operating income, it's steadily declining. So let's take the most recent year. It's about 1651. They were paying about 32.5% in taxes. You have excess depreciation of about 114 million. So you've got a net operating profit after tax of about $1.2 billion. The market capitalization was 6.9 billion. They actually had quite a lot of debt. They had some cash. The net debt was 2.8 billion. So to buy the whole enterprise and get that 1.2 billion in NOPEC would have cost you about 9.76 billion. That is about a 12.6% return. In terms of multiples, you're paying about 8 times net operating profit after tax. And the question is, how many people think that's a lovely return for something like a newspaper? And people at the time bought newspapers, including people who should have known better. Because if you thought about the standard valuation techniques, they showed that an 8 times multiple was pretty reasonable in terms of the difference between a cost of capital and a growth rate. They retained about a quarter of the profits, so the cash return was a quarter, 3/4 of the 12.6. So if I take 3/4 of this, I get about 9.4% cash return. They reinvested 3.2%. You think they did a good job? They had a lot of above average return investments. No, it was stupid internet investments. At best, they destroyed 25 cents of every dollar they reinvested. So of the 3.2% they were reinvesting, they were barely creating 2.4% of value. So basically that 12.6% was worth about 11.8% in value created. Why is it less than the 12.6? Because you're destroying value with some malinvestment. At what rate do you think this franchise is shrinking? And remember, when franchises shrink, you don't get asset recovery. What do you think your organic growth here is? It's at least 7% a year. This is going to be half the size it was. Plus, you're going to lose operating scale at a minimum. Profits are going to shrink you, and remember, your earnings driven by 7% a year. If that's the organic growth, and there's no real capital recovery to offset it, I start with the 11.8% and I subtract the 7% organic growth. What's the return here?
4.8% per year.
Do you think that in early 2008 it was worth investing in newspapers for a 4.8% return when the market return was about 7-8? I mean, newspapers were above or below average in riskiness. They're above average riskiness. It's a below market return. There's not really a lot of uncertainty about that. There's no way in the world any of those numbers are going to get you above the market return. So what was the problem with everybody who was excited about buying newspapers at an 8x multiple? They looked in a space where the imprecision of the valuation estimates supported that stupidity. If they had looked in the return space, they would have seen immediately, as Warren Buffett did, because one of the students who went out from this class in the past to ask him about newspapers, he said, what are you going to do about me? What's the future of newspapers? Because all these smart, supposedly smart people were investing in them. And he said, if I didn't have an emotional attachment to them, I'd get rid of them all. And that's presumably because he understood this calculation. Now, you ought to have a sense that this is much more revealing than an 8x or a 6x or a 4x multiple. Because it tells you at an existing multiple exactly what return you're getting. In terms of Walmart, it was trading at about, this was done a while ago, so Tay has a, it's trading at a net profit return of about 7%. They have a fair amount of debt. They were trading on an earnings multiple of about 6, I'm sorry, about 8, no, I'm thinking about earnings multiple of about 16-17, which is like a 6% return. Their net profit was a little higher because the debt was cheaper. So you have about a 7% return that you're getting if you bought the whole enterprise after tax. The dividend yield was about 2%. They weren't doing significant buybacks. They were reinvesting 5%, therefore, in the company. Now, there are two kinds of things you want to look at with Walmart. There they were doing two separate things with your money. With about a third of it, they were investing overseas. They were doing things like buying Asda in Britain at an inflated price and probably about a 5-7% return at best. They were doing things like opening up in Germany and Japan where things were almost a total loss. If their cost of capital was 10, they were probably making at best half that for the third that they were spending overseas. If you did the same analysis on store openings for Walmart, what you got was about a 20% value creation. By the way, the difference between Home Depot and Walmart and why even with cannibalization, the new Walmart stores were worth more is that Home Depot did not do any regional infrastructure. Home Depot ran and has only just started to change every single store as a one-off store. So they didn't concentrate the way Walmart did on regional economies of scale. And because they had the regional economies of scale, and they've been reasonably careful to open in regions where they already have the infrastructure, the incremental return was about 12% on, or actually I think higher, it was about 15% on those stores. If you look, took the average, one-third, two-thirds, it was about a 12% return on a 10% cost of capital. So of the 5% reinvested, you were getting $1.20 in value for every dollar reinvested. It's worth about 6. The organic growth GDP looked like it was 4. They're low-income customers. They sell goods rather than services. Their organic growth was likely to be 1%. So even though it was selling at this historically low multiple, 14 times, You have a 1% organic growth, a 2% cash return, a 6% reinvestment return that could easily go down if they decided to get stupid again about international expansion. You have a 9% return. Now, in a 7-8% market, is that exciting? No, but is it a bad stock to invest in? It's an above average return. If you bought it at a 15% return, would you sell it before you got to a 9% return? Where's my sell decision, Doc? You probably sell around that point. So you're not going to buy it. It's not exciting, but it's not a disaster like the net. And remember, all these things are selling at historically low multiples. And then there's the one that was selling at the time. It had $3.20 of sustainable earnings. It was trading at $16. This was sort of at the end of 2008. So this was American Express. You have a 20% earnings return. Basically, they were distributing two-thirds of that. They were retaining about a third, which is 7%. Again, where was that money going? In the long run, it was going to loans. They really didn't need it for anything else. The loans economics you can see from what they do. But basically, they were charging their customers 9.5% above their cost of funds. The average write-off rates, they were temporarily higher, were about 5.5%. So the net margin was 4, safe leverage was 8-1. It's a 32% return pre-tax, they was at a 37% tax rate. Again, at the margin, they had an opportunity to earn about 20% on incremental investment in the long run. Their cost of capital, you think, is 10. That's a 2-1 value. So the 7% reinvestment is worth 14. Then you have the reinvestment return on the 7 side of a WACC of 14. I did a high WACC, I guess, for this. So you have 7 times 1.5, which is about 10. The organic growth is GDP plus. You think billings for American Express grow faster or slower than GDP? Faster, because they tend to be rich people. So if GDP is 4.5, you're talking about maybe 6. So you've got a cash return of about 13%, a reinvestment return of 10, which is, I've done this math wrong. So it's a 13 plus 10, which is 23 plus 5. I double counted the 7. So you've got a 28% total return. So even if the cost of capital for American Express, because it was a financial at that point, was 10 or 11, you still had an enormous margin of safety. You still want to see whether American Express is going to go bankrupt. It wasn't, by the way, because they were shrinking their loan book and putting money temporarily in cash. And these are long-run returns. They could not have turned over a single piece of debt for 3 years, and they still would have been okay. And if the economy was still in that state for 3 years, life would have been terrible. So what happened to these stocks? Obviously, Gannett is worth a lot less than it was at the time. Walmart has stayed almost exactly where it was. It's fairly priced. American Express went down from $17 a share to $10 a share. You buy it there, it's at just about, what, 37, 38 today. But the important thing is that the multiples tell a very different story here than the return data. And the return calculations, it seems to me, give you a much clearer view of what you're buying when you buy growth. So the value approach to growth stocks is not an asset approach at all. It's a return approach. So if you're going to get into this game, you're going to again get into it from a perspective that in valuation terms is very different from what everybody else does. It should be much more revealing given the success of these people. And the only last word I leave you with is, if you decide to do this, you better wear the investment equivalent of a condom. You want to do this very carefully because the psychology is against you. It's got to be a growth company that everybody hates. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
the guy who runs it. You'll show up there.
On the value investing book.
Right.
Although I already read it.
That's
I finished the book yesterday, but so I've been learning a lot about my own company, by the way.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, okay. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you. Thank you.